Ankle Dick.
You're my nephew. I want to do whatever I can to help you.
Action! I always said I wasn't going to do it. I also said I would never say never.
Cara mia, fammi presente mio figlio, Richard Moltisanti.
Everybody calls me Dicky.
Sopranos came along and suddenly television was transformed and it gave birth to the golden age where there's no division between movies and TV.
Who the fuck are you?
A guy who one time put out somebody's eye for talking to him like that.
It was the most cinematic, cool, unnerving thing I'd seen. But for me, it was sort of the gateway into that scale and that level of television, because I had never known that TV could be that way.
I think that that's the thing about this franchise. It's about the ugly things that we do. It's about the psychology. Part of the fun of that series was seeing Tony on the couch, trying to get to the bottom of all that.
I think what makes the show so iconic is it's ripe with humor and tragedy, moments of honesty, romance, intricate family dynamics, and ultimately it's about that. It's about the gang of family.
The Sopranos in Italy is not famous like here, but it's perfect. The script, the characters, the actors.
There's so much love for the original material and so much love for that canon, so you have to serve that. And it is a whole different set of characters because it's a different time, but when I first read the script, the tone of Sopranos was unmistakable.
I didn't catch the name.
Pussy. Don't worry, Father, it's not what you think it is.
And action.
I've always been interested in Newark because my mother grew up there, and we used to go down to Newark on Saturday nights to have dinner with my grandparents. It's always been interesting to me. When the riots happened, I guess I was like 20 or so. It was a wake-up call.
And action!
Your brother, my father, he passed in the riots.
So much tragedy in your life.
The backdrop of the story is the racial unrest that was going on in Newark at that time. And these riots break out in the city.
I think Harold is a person who, like a lot of people of color at that time in this country, were painfully aware of what their position was in society and how big they were allowed to dream for themselves.
When are you gonna come back and work for me again?
Got stuff of my own percolating.
As Black Power movement starts to take shape, Harold decides he's going to kind of mount a revolution.
Gotta do something about Dickie Matasani. And we're looking at the patterns that America has repeated again and again, and sort of our collective psychosis, and why we have done the things again and again as a society. Why do we need these riots to happen again and again?
David, he doesn't sort of look away from the dark things in America, but he finds humor in them, and he finds some shred of hope and redemption.
Get the fuck away from the car!
But it's a pretty dark vision that he plays with.
Something you better see.
That's Belmont Avenue.
So much of this must have lived in Mr. Chase's heart and imagination while he was writing it. You know, these characters, they all have such a deep and rich history.
When my brother's away, everything goes through me.
You got diarrhea.
Comedian.
The characters are incredibly vibrant and yet very real. And all the characters themselves contain these contradictions.
I'm getting nobody.
Dickie, consider me your brother from now on.
The focus on the intricate family dynamic, I think, is so relatable to every one of us.
Anthony got kicked out of school.
Let me go talk to him.
He only listens to Dickie.
A movie is usually the hero quest model, where you follow one character, one guy or one woman, and her crisis and coming out of it. This is not that kind of movie. It doesn't have just one storyline.
We're gonna star first Black numbers bank in the Central War.
No more whitey scut.
Growing up with the family takes a toll.
When there's like a big transformation that's required, you just need time to live with it and to research and find your way in. I've had the luxury of that on this job.
I try to set an example for my nephew. I do all kinds of good things.
Maybe some of the things you choose to do aren't God's favorite.
This role was a role that allowed me to use and explore my own personal history in ways that I really haven't been able to in any other job I've done up until now.
It wasn't right how they treated you.
I murdered a maid guy in our own family. I'm here for a good reason. You don't need to help me.
There's so much source material to look at, and the characters were played so perfectly and are so memorable. You can't ignore that. You have to bring some essence of that character. And so finding that essence and paying homage to the performances that came before, and yet not just doing an impression.
Truck's not gonna unload itself.
Trying to take those rhythms and those sound changes on yourself and find the organic place that they come from.
It's a tricky thing. You don't know how much to ask an actor to do a kind of impersonation or how much to find their own version of the character.
Get inside, both of you!
You know, Billy playing Paulie and John playing Sil, and I think people are gonna flip when they see Mikey and Corey. I just think that that's gonna be really, really exciting for people.
Ah, assistant!
Junior, it's the summer of love.
The movie is a new territory in that the main character that we spend most of our time with is a character that was referred to in the television show but never seen, Dickie Moltisanti, father of Chris Moltisanti, mentor to Tony Soprano. So in many ways it's his story.
Do you know who I'd want to be? Your Uncle Dickie.
But in some ways it's Tony's story. It's the origin story of Tony Soprano.
I try to be good.
Try harder.
We knew it was going to be hard to find a guy who could both act and believably be the guy that grew into James Gandolfini. And we were doing a casting call all over country, East Coast, West Coast, but we were always quietly talking about Michael at the same time.
Gonna be a linebacker, huh? Coach says I'm gonna be starting.
We read a bunch of other kids, and I said, we should really try Michael. And there was no doubt about it.
The results tell us. He's a leader.
He's got a D-plus average.
Hey, jerk off.
What'd you say?
Well, he doesn't apply himself, but he is smart.
I'm roughly the age of the show. I was born while they were filming the first season. I don't know if I knew who Tony Soprano was or what it meant, but I auditioned 3 times over a series of months and started watching the show and read the script and met with Alan and David, and it was a long process, but I started to really fall in love with the fact that he's different. He's a much different Tony. This is not the Tony that people saw. He's sensitive, he's curious, he's very open to things everyone else is closed off to. And I thought, maybe I could do this.
You know stealing the test was wrong.
But if you're gonna kick me out of school, I mean, you should just do it instead of us talking about it.
I couldn't have done this without Michael Gandolfini. I relied on him so much. There was a spiritual aspect.
You look nice.
There was no one else who could have played this. Nobody. James lives on in him. It's genetics.
What really struck me was actually his posture and his gait. James Gandolfini was too tall for his own good. There was a sense that he was constantly bending down to deal with everybody around him. And while Michael is not quite as tall as him, he still has this slouch, which is incredibly evocative of that. And he has this sweet smile. You know, they've augmented it with a little mouthpiece to give him a chipped tooth and a little bit of a lisp like his father.
I missed you, Dad.
A lot of these people watched Michael grow up. James gave so much of his life to Tony Soprano and to this franchise. And so for his son to hold his father's legacy so close, for his son to get to carry the torch for his dad in this way, it's a lot bigger than a movie.
Hey, Anthony, you go see Dirty Harry like I told you?
You gotta ask yourself, do you feel lucky? Or do you punk?
We talked a lot about the look on this. It's a funny challenge because Sopranos was a TV show that had real cinematic aspirations.
The Soprano world of the series is, I always said, was sort of the post-John Gotti world. Before that, it's generally considered that most of the people who were in their line of business kept a much lower profile. Their houses weren't ostentatious. Maybe their cars were a little more ostentatious.
That's Poupette's house.
What are you mad at me for?
It's really great to come back and flesh out some of the things that we'd always heard about. There are a few of these locations that are being brought back for the movie that will obviously mean a lot to audiences who know the show.
It's interesting because Holston's was only ever seen once. It has this monumental weight in the series, so to sort of see them brought to life has really been a lot of fun.
I think the reoccurring theme with any sort of gangster movie is always that their appearance is very important. I mean, not only their clothes, but their hair and everything that goes along with it. What they're holding, what kind of cigar, you know.
It's my first time with a 16 dress, and they make my character. I feel so different, so tall, and more important than me in real life. And they are magicians.
We used a lot of blues, especially on Dickie. Blues, grays, silvers, and everyone else has their strict palette. So, like, take Livia, for instance. She's very pastel, very blues, very teals, little tiny bit of pink.
The bitter, the frosty, the frigid, the chilly tones for Livia.
Oh, look at you. Not a pound. You're just a regular Charlton Heston.
To make beautiful Vera look like Livia. Vera had this great idea. I should have a nose. And everybody's like, oh, what a great idea. So I brought on my friend Mike Marino, who's a brilliant prosthetic designer. He created this beautiful nose for her that we put on every day. And it's pretty amazing how that changes her face.
Alan's just been really trusting of me. And I feel like he offers just enough of a nudge this way and that way of different moments and scenes that have been really invaluable to me, but he's also let me have a lot of freedom.
Come in. Let me show you something.
My gift to you.
I want to go to college. I can't get caught with shit like this.
David is so smart. Every single word that is said is thought about and really adjusted to make a perfect script in a perfect world.
It was really Sopranos that made me see gangsters in a different way. It takes the life we're all living, the conflicts we have, and sort of heightens it. And I think it's rooting for the anti-hero that is sort of an American thing.
These are uniquely American stories. In his own way, David's putting us on the couch and asking us to look at what we've been doing for generations.
As far as your nephew goes,
I'm listening.
Stay out of his life.